So. I will start with a short introduction of myself. I'm a BI developer, and all my IT career, I work with data in different aspects: data quality, data loading from legacy systems, data visualizations, some reports, dashboards, and I work with all this stuff almost 20 years. So during this period, I tried lots of different BI tools, BI platforms. And what we will talk about today is based on my experience and on the BI platforms I worked with. So it's some kind of aggregation of accumulated experience. I just want to notice that I didn't work with Power BI, but from what I read about it, about data security in Power BI as well, I assume that this will be applicable to Power BI as well. So all materials will be based on Tableau experience, typical Spotfire experience, Looker as well. So let's get started. First of all, we will talk about why data security is important in Power BI. Different levels or layers of security in BI platforms. Differences between data exclusions and data masking. This is more related to row level security. So we will look into some general common aspects and more detailed to row level security. So difference between live data and preloaded or cached data in dashboards. Performance from both sides, UI and server part. And important things to consider when we plan to implement row-level security, and we'll review interesting real business case. So what are the reasons of data security in BI? So you know, data security is important part of data governance, and BI dashboards, BI platforms is part of corporate systems, and data security is applicable here as well. And primary reason is actually internal reason, company policies based on mainly on need to know principle, when user should have access only to those information which is required to user job functions. And also there is external reason you should know about GDPR. This is especially important when you work with customer sensitive data, and your company might be a subject of external audit, and this impacts your company reputation. So it's especially when you work with PII data, this is important as well. Important to keep in mind and be very careful working with this data. When we in the project very beginning, when we are choosing, making decision about which BI platform to choose for our application, for our system, we usually do a comparison of different platforms, comparing their features, their how they match to requirements of a particular project. And one of aspects we pay attention is security with which this platform can provide to us. So first of all, this is authentication, how this BI platform authenticate users. Usually, BI platforms have embedded internal authentication. You can create user, you can manage permissions for this user. But for big corporates, it is important to integrate with existing corporate directory. and implement some kind of single sign-on for the AI platform as well. So we pay attention to this point. Next point is activity tracking. How your BI platform records, monitors administrative or user actions in the system. This is useful to troubleshoot any security incidents. But also this point is important also for other tasks as well. Oftentimes, BI platform offers pre-built embedded audit dashboards, which shows you who, when, accessed which data, which dashboards, and you may identify most used dashboards, or you can identify outsiders dashboards which are not used, but probably they are scheduled for regular refresh and consumes server resources. So you may take actions to optimize your resources utilization and improve performance. And even when you see that some dashboards is more used than others, you may take some actions in advance to improve performance in this dashboard, improve usability, improve user experience, and this will impact how user perception about your system. Next point is object level security. This, for me, this is very similar to file system. In each BI platform which I saw, probably naming was different, but the sense was the same. We have projects or spaces, they are similar to folders in file system. And we can set up different access for these objects, separating access for different teams, show them only dashboards which are specific for their job function. And next level is interesting and BI platform specific. This is feature level security. Again, comparing to file system, you may have access to read, write, execute, and manage permissions. Similar way in BI platform, you may have features like view underlying data, export data. So this way we can manage these features available for each user or group. And most interesting for me, and I suppose for you, is row level security. This is how system allows you to filter your data in dashboard, implementing row level security policies for each user or group. In general, this means that the same dashboard for different users will show different data, different volumes. So same set of visualizations, but numbers will be different according to user row level security policies. And also column level security, this is similar to row level, but not horizontal, it's more vertical. So we may have some sensitive attribute sensitive columns, which should be available only for certain users or groups. And the BI platform may allow you to set up such access or not. Okay. Just I want to notice if you have any questions during the presentation, don't hesitate to stop me and ask your question. I do not see a question chat panel in the presentation mode, so you can do this in voice. Next part is leave data and preloaded data. This is we start here about role level security part. And if you worked with BI platforms, you may know that there are two main options how we access data. With a live connection, data is when user open dashboard, BI platform sends a query to the database. And in this case, in case of live connection, we may incorporate user policies logic into this query. And we will have result already based on the current user who is opening dashboard. And this live connection is not always good for end user because of sometimes we have a huge amount of data and data loading is not quick enough. Sometimes it depends on the database we use under hood. If database cannot return your data very quickly, the other option is to use preloaded data. This means that we have some scheduler on BI platform side and data is loaded according to this scheduler and saved, cache is saved somewhere in BI platform side. Depending on BI platform, it could be in memory or in some file system specific format. But what we need to keep in mind here, we know who opens dashboard only at the dashboard opening moment. And in case with preloaded data, we cannot incorporate specific user filtering into database query. So we need to preload all the data and apply user specific filtering only at report opening moment. And you can imagine that this will take additional time for report opening. And depending on your SLAs, your requirements, how quickly your dashboard should be opened, this gives you different options about your about the logic for this filtering, how this should be implemented. We'll talk about this also a little bit later. Next one is about data exclusion and data masking. So user-specific filtering means that we completely filter out restricted data. This means that this data will not be shown in aggregations and also not available in detailed view. But the possible cases when user, according to policies, user should not have access to detailed data. It must be restricted for this user, but according to the job function, this user must have access to aggregated to see to aggregated data to see the whole picture. For example, this is some kind of regional manager who must know the whole picture of the of his region, but should not have access to some sensitive data. And in this case, you may think about data masking. So we do load all the data, but data which is restricted for this particular user, in details, we will mask sensitive attributes. In this example, you may see green rows, which are completely open and available for this user. Red ones are restricted for him. So all these rows, green and red, will be counted properly in the aggregated view. will show the whole picture of number of roles, number of sales in this region, for example. But when user drill to details, sensitive information about Australia data will be hidden with this masked values. And for masking, we may use two different approaches. We may just mask sensitive attributes with some static text, something like this data is masked. Or we may use some hash-based function to generate masked value, but these values will be different for different original rows. And sometimes it's quite important because I had a case. It was typical Spotify, and there was an option to show aggregated view as is with whole data, and for detailed view, set up some not visible for user and for end user filter, which hides restricted data. But it was very confusing to user. In aggregated data, he see that there were 10 users, for example, 10 users in this particular period. But when he drills to details, he see only 3. And it was confusing. Why? Why? So they asked for masking, and not just with static text. They wanted to be able to identify different roles that, for example, one customer have few orders, several orders, and they wanted to identify that this is one customer with their with his 3 orders. This is another customer with his 4 orders, and something like that. So in this case, we need to use this hash-based function. Any question here?
Yeah, I have one question here. So is this masking applied on, let's say, front-end side, or we need to perform it before loading to the table?
Good question. I will touch this a little bit later. Actually, both cases possible.
Yeah, because, for example, if we apply it on the internal side, then how can we, for example, aggregate on customer address, for example? I mean, group by customer address, or, for example, other columns that are masked.
In this case, we need to know which columns are sensitive. So this need to be agreed with customer. And we need to keep in mind that columns which are involved in the aggregated view, dimensions which we use to build visualizations, filters which are used on UI to filter data. This, we cannot mask these columns because they are involved in the aggregation process. So we should mask only those details which we show in detailed view and not involved into aggregated into summary view.
Okay, so for example, if let's say a manager wants to group by, for example, customer address and see probably more general view, like not detailed, but general, like, for example, how many customers is from this region, for example. So they can do it, yeah?
In this example, you can see that customer region, for example, column, Eastern Europe, APAC, and customer country, Ukraine, Australia, they are not masked. They have original values, and they could be used in summary aggregation and UI filtering.
Okay, but if it is masked, then they won't be able to group it, yeah?
Actually, yeah. And again, this depends on the requirements and agreement with business users, which attributes are sensitive and which are not and should be used in the summary.
Okay, thank you.
This one. And a very interesting point about hide restricted or show allowed. So when we define our security policies for users, there is something similar to gathering statistics in the database. So you know that mostly, for example, mostly your data is restricted. And for example, you have 10 regions, and for each user, only one or two regions will be available, or others will be restricted. In this case, it is reasonable for you to track only allowance, and your entitlement matrix will look like this user has access to this region and to this region. Another user has access to these three regions. So you track what is allowed. In other case, if your data is mostly allowed and only a small piece of data is restricted, it is reasonable to keep in the entitlement matrix to keep restrictions. And actually, in general case, if not restricted, then allowed should work the same way as if not allowed, then restricted. With the only exception, what if user permissions are not defined in this policies matrix? So if we use restrictions and user not defined in this matrix, this means everything is available for the user. Is it true? It depends on the requirement and the workflow. And same way for not allowed, if you keep allowance, user is not listed there. This means everything is restricted for this user. Why this is important to keep in mind? Because usually this policies matrix is stored and maintained somewhere out of the BI platform. It could be in the database or in some third system. And when user requests access to BI platform itself, it receives access to dashboards, to folders dashboards, and can open. And what will see this user if he already has access, but his permissions not yet defined in the entitlement matrix? So if in case if we keep restrictions and nothing is restricted, this user will see all the data. Usually there is some delay between adding access to BI platform itself and adding user to policies entitlements matrix. And this delay is enough to steal your data or to raise a security incident. And you need to keep this in mind and have some workaround for this. So in my example, in my recent project, in this case, we did additional validation, additional check on BI platform site, on dashboard site. We checked if user is present in the entitlements matrix. And if not, we just hide all the data. So dashboard has two different data sets inside. One data set is main dashboard data and another is entitlements matrix. And we do user filtering by username for this entitlements matrix. If a user is not present there, this part will be empty and we do inner join. and have empty result. Next one is UI performance. We know that, again, only when user is opening this dashboard, we know who this user is and can check user entitlements and what is allowed or what is not allowed for this user. And this definitely requires additional efforts from the dashboard from and impacts data load time. And we need to check what is the impact. How significant is the performance degradation in this case? And it depends on the how complex this filtering logic is. And it is complex. If it is complex enough, we need to think about simplifying this entitlements matrix, moving complex calculations somewhere on the database side outside of BI platform, and provide to BI side only simple values like yes or no to make this filtering simple and fast. But apart from UI performance, important to note also server performance. And this is a real issue we faced again with typical Spotfire. This depends actually on the BI platform itself and how it utilizes server resources, how it works with cache data, where it is stored, and how what is the organization of concurrent access to this cache data. Let's imagine we have a dashboard which with huge data set under it. And this data set is cached. And 10 users open this dashboard and they all use this cached data set. For typical Spotfire, we had access to server side and we were able to monitor resources utilization and what is happening there when multiple users perform some actions. So how it was organized there? This shared data set. So dashboard is cached and saved to cache in memory on the server side. When user opens dashboard, for this user specific session, a new data set created. What user can do on the dashboard? User can apply some filters on UI. User can do can switch to some tabs, do some export. So actually, most important here is that user applies some filtering. Some filters are from UI, which user do manually. Some filters could be not visible to users, but embedded into dashboard logic by developers. In this case, session-specific data set looks like just an index in the database. There are pointers to the records in the shared data set, which match user filtering conditions. And this session-specific data set is small enough, it's just an index. And what we faced with was data masking calculations for this cached dashboard. So when we first attempt was to implement masking as runtime calculations. So the data set has original values, original columns, and for user we show calculated columns, which this calculation logic checks if this row is restricted for user. If restricted, then we put masked value here. If not restricted, then we take original value. And what this mean in terms of these server-side data sets? Actually, we change data set. For each user, we do change data set. And in this case, shared data set is cloned and then changed. And this is not an index anymore. It's a full size data set. And when we had, for example, original data set is 10 gigabytes, and we have 15 users opening this dashboard. So we have 150 gigabytes to be kept in memory. And there was significant performance degradation. And then we came to another approach. In our case, this is next slide. So in our case, most data was always allowed for all users, and only about 30% was a subject for access checks. And what we did? We did on the database side, we did rows multiplication for each those rows which are subject of access check. So we increased number of records in the data set. But actually this gave us the same performance from UI side, almost the same from database side. So for each row which is subject of access check, we had two rows in data set, original one and masked one. And in final dashboard, only one of those rows was shown, depending on user permission. If row is restricted for this user, we show masked one. If row is not restricted, we show original one. So this way we turned this calculation into filtering, actually into filtering, not calculation, not changing the set on BI platform side, but into filtering. And this way we again return to index side, index, back. We turned back to the session specific data sets, which looks like index, and the problem was resolved. What is also important to know about this user specific filtering? Usually this is part of development work to incorporate this security filtering, but oftentimes BI platforms allows some kind of self-service to end users. So user can download this dashboard workbook, open in the offline mode in the desktop application and edit. So user can change this user-specific filtering and see restricted data. We need to keep in mind this and take an action in advance. So if it's okay to disable downloading and editing, it's okay, we can incorporate security logic in dashboard itself and be sure a user will not change it. But if there is some kind of self-service or users are allowed to modify, we need to move this user-specific filtering out of downloadable content. It should be level up somewhere on the, if you use, for example, like in Looker, if you use model, the user are allowed to operate with this model in the way they need to for their job. So this user specific filtering should be on the model level, not in dashboard, because even in Looker you can do user specific filtering in dashboard level, but you can do also in the model level. And when we are allowing to manipulate with dashboards, with looks, with attributes, build custom explorers, this is must have to have this filtering in the model, not in the looks or dashboards. Before we move to these use cases, I just want to note that mostly in the BI platforms I saw, the ways how they allows to implement this user-specific filtering are quite simple. You can do some filtering based on the user ID, or you can do some filtering or logic based on the user group or user role. So actually two simple ways, user ID or groups roles. And here there will be three cases how to decide which way to use. First case actually is not about role level security in BI at all. You may know role level security could be implemented also on the database side. I have never seen this implemented in my projects, but I know this is possible. And if somebody has such experience, at least for me, it would be interesting to hear. And probably it could be subject of similar presentation and in community. So in case if the role level security is implemented on the database side, how BI platform should behave? We need to use leave data connection, because this data connection must be user specific. We need to use current user identity to connect to the database and query data. And in this case, nothing to do else on the BI tool side. Important to note here that we, in this case, we cannot use caching, scheduled caching data preload. So it always will be leave data connection, because we need to use current user identity. Second case is when we have many users which are grouped to small or limited number of roles or groups. These groups are incorporated into BI tool, configured manually in BI platform, or integrated with a corporate directory, doesn't matter. And we have a policies matrix which is based on these groups or roles. And this group's membership is managed outside of BI tool. In this case, we may use group-based filtering. Why it is important to have small or limited number of roles groups? Because using groups in the queries logic, it is some kind of hard coding. In case of user belongs to the group XXX, we use this logic. In case if user belongs to the group XYZ, we use another logic. And this is hard code, and this is not easy to maintain actually, if you have lots of such groups. And if we have really many users, it's important to manage them, their membership outside of BI tool. Because actually user management is not a stuff which you should do with BI platform. Actually, in all other cases, the best way which will work is to use user ID to perform user-specific filtering. So in this case, in our entitlement matrix is defined for each user. And we just apply user-specific filtering, not group-based, but user-based. We know user ID for current session, and we do apply this for to our data set in the dashboard. Any questions here? Okay, moving further. So what to consider when you think about how to implement row-level security in your dashboards? First of all, you need to think about how many dashboards you have where you need to implement policies. And think about, are the policies the same for each dashboard? So can you cover all these dashboards with one single entitlements matrix, or you need to have more than one? Then think about which users' attributes define the security policy. In some cases, it could be user location. So if I'm located in Ukraine and I can see and they have a global some e-commerce project, I can see sales only from Ukraine, this example. Real cases could be different. Which data attributes define this security policy from the data side? So in the example above, we use country Ukraine for sales. So we use country for user location, and we use country for sales where these orders were done. This is simplified, very simplified case. How complex is security policies business logic? Because in case if we have more than one data attribute defining your security policies, you may have additional logic how to combine all these attributes, how to probably sometimes these attributes are managed somewhere outside and you need to access that third system to get these attributes from there first. How many users do you have in your BI platform and how often new users appear in the system? These users' attributes which are defined in security policies, where these attributes are stored and maintained. Because if we, for example, if we are talking about user location, commonly it's stored in the corporate HR system. And to know where is user located, you need to query this information from corporate HR. Are there any exceptional cases? Because even if a common policy matrix is defined, there are possible cases when user is located in Ukraine again, but this user is regional manager for Europe, for the whole Europe. And according to the common policies, for example, England is restricted for him. But as a manager, this user must have access to this data as well. and how these exceptions are managed, how they are maintained, and how should we overcome these exceptions. And last but not least is performance. If your logic is complex, if you have many attributes to pull for these calculations, is your BI platform, your system, able to do this quickly enough to not impact user experience, UI performance? So answering this question will direct you to some or another solution. And probably next we will review a real case, and you will see how these questions impacts the decision. So in my previous project, we had about 30 dashboards, and security policies were the same for all these 30 dashboards. So we were able to cover all these requirements with one entitlements matrix. Dashboards used preloaded data, so we had to load the whole data set and apply user-specific filters only at dashboard opening moment. It was customer data domain, so very sensitive data. And depending on who customer is it private individuals or is it legal entity, there were different rules. So for private individuals, there was a PII rule, for all others, general rule. And if for the same location we have both, PII rule has higher priority. We need to apply a PII rule. Customer data visibility, so it's a data attributes defining user access. There were actually three or even four attributes: business division, business location, client consent for a particular business location, and actually client type, private individual or legal entity, also impacts the decision of which rule to apply, PII or general. There were about 1,000 of users in BI platform, and for user to identify restrictions or access, it was a primary business function and user location division. And there were possible exceptions which were defined by assigning specific role. And all these business function exceptional roles were managed by third system. User location division was managed by another system, corporate HR system. And permission matrix stored and maintained in another system. So actually to identify for one role, to identify is it restricted for current user or not, we had to ask three different systems to get all required attributes and make a decision, is it restricted or not. So this is how it looks. So one system to track user business functions and exceptional roles. One system which keeps common policies matrix. One system is corporate HR system. And we had entitlement service, which collects data, which keeps asks data from all these three systems and returns result entitlements for a particular user. So what we did in this case, I will come back here. So we know BI platform was incorporated with corporate LDAP groups, and our data storage had a job to to take a list of users from the ABI platform, which has access to our project. Then for each such user, this job asks for entitlements from the entitlement service. And this entitlements, it's interesting because usually you have answer like yes or no, restricted or allowed. In this case, there was third option, maybe. This means that you need to do additional checks to check client consent. If client provide consent to show his data in this particular business location division. So we did collect unique combinations of data attributes with defining access to particular role. It's a party type, depending on party type, policy name, which need to be applied here, business division, business location, and consent if provided. And this for this list of unique combinations, we apply these entitlements we receive from entitlement service and have a final decision if it is restricted or not. As this data dictionary was huge enough and we have thousands of users, so table was huge enough for BI platform to query. And we decided to concatenate all users for whom particular row is available and keep it as a list comma separated values. And we used concatenated DPR key, data privacy key, which is concatenation of those attributes which defines decision, is it restricted or not. So this calculation was part of the daily ETL job. And in BI platform, we just took this pre-calculated entitlements, our final entitlements matrix, and joined to the main data set using that DPR key, and filter out checking if current user is a substring of visible for column. Important to note here that you need to keep in mind string length restriction on both database side, BI platform side, and also data driver side, because we faced issue when database side has no length restriction, but driver, which was used between BI platform and database, had string restriction, and a string was just truncated. And in this case, our user-specific filtering was not correct. So what we did in this case, we just split in the database query, we split this value into two, and then during filtering, we use two columns to check if user is substring or not. I assume this is final slide.
Quick question.
Yeah.
Which system was used in last case?
In last case, it was Tableau.
Tableau, mm-hmm. Okay.
Can you tell regarding this last case, what's the point to store it in such generalized way where we have a list of users in one cell, not have like a few tables with some relational connection between these tables? Because here we get a problem that we cannot put all users in one cell, in one row, right? So we have to make some workarounds with a few of them just because we have string limitations. So why not to have a few tables? like for each user, you could have this relation to this role, which you have here in data visibility dictionary.
Remember, in this case, we have about 1,000 users in BI platform site. And unique combinations of the data privacy attributes, we had about 4 million of these unique combinations. So to have the full matrix, you need to multiply this 4 million to this 1,000. And actually, as we use preloaded data, we need, when BI platform runs this prelocation on the scheduler, it need to load all this data. It was an issue in terms of performance because Tableau has a 2 hours limit for scheduler job. And another issue we had that our data storage was in Germany and BI platform was in US, and significant delay caused by the distance.
Okay, thank you.
And oftentimes we just had not had enough time to load all the data to Tableau. So we tried to minimize the volume as possible.
I see, thank you.